Good morning from sunny and cool Los Angeles, and good evening to those of you in very cold Athens. Welcome to Hellenic Together 3.0, the third in a series of lectures highlighting the exceptional collections and exhibitions put on by the Benaki Museum in Athens. My name is Sharon Gerstel, and I have the honor of directing the UCLA Stavros Niarchos Foundation Center for the Study of Hellenic Culture. Hellenic Together is one of many collaborative programs that we conduct with the Benaki Museum, and we are very grateful for this stimulating partnership and for the support of the museum's wonderful academic director, Yorgos Manginis. We are so glad to have you with us today, safe in your homes and with chairs pulled forward to the screens, to learn about some truly interesting and important works of ceramic art. So now I would like to invite my dear friend, George Manginis, Academic Director of the Benaki Museum, to introduce today's wonderful speaker, Yorgo.
Thank you very much, Sharon. Good morning, afternoon, and evening to all from Athens. Now, it feels that this Hellenic Together series of lectures was too short. We hardly said hello 3 weeks ago, and tonight we have to say goodbye. But of course, we'll be back. Hellenic Together was our chance to meet regularly and bring together the UCLA Stavros Niarchos Foundation Center community and the Benaki Museum community. We started in spring 2020, and we have covered anything from antiquity to the 20th century, from British eccentrics to Greek fustanelades, from ecclesiastical art to modern art, from photography to ceramics, from China to New York City, from weddings in classical Athens to Christ's Passion, and from biscuits to the 1821 revolution. It has been a lovely journey, and we thank you for joining us. 9 lectures from the first 2 series can already be found at the Benaki Museum website under multimedia. The 3 lectures of the current series will also be added in a few days' time. The first one was given by Mara Perikoku on a show of Philhellenic art from 4 private collections organized to coincide with the bicentennial of the revolution. The second lecture by Spiros Kizis was on another show that is actually running as we speak at the Piraeus 138 building until the end of February. It told the story of the most iconic Greek Papadopoulou biscuits. Tonight's lecture will serve as a bridge, so to say, from the celebrations of the Greek bicentenary to the commemoration of a much more sobering moment in Greek history, the Asia Minor War, the so-called 1922 catastrophe, and the ensuing uprooting of Asia Minor Hellenism. Our lecture will refer to a superb exhibition that is currently shown at the Benaki Museum of Islamic Art and will run until the 27th of March, 2022. So if you find yourselves in Athens, there is plenty of time to catch it. Now, we have a tradition that we do a competition between usually two foodstuffs, two sort of sweets or savory things. And for tonight, our competition is between kataifi, the sort of hairy pudding that we've all had if we visited Greece, and ekmek paroto. So you can vote using the chat function, and I will keep the score. So I repeat, either Kataifi or Ekmek Pagoto. Use chat and vote for your preferred pudding. I'm delighted to introduce today's speaker, Mr. Dinos Kogias, who curated the exhibition on Kütahya and wrote the beautifully produced book which accompanies it. Dinos works as a lawyer in Athens, but the museum community knows him as a collector and as a scholar of modern Greek, Ottoman, and Balkan ceramics. He's a founding member of DIKTIO, a Southeast European ceramics research group, the members of which have revolutionized the study of this, in so far, rather obscure field. They have used social media, as well as scholarly meetings and publications, to allow the general public access to their considerable knowledge. And this is a knowledge I'm very keen on. Now, Dinos has published two books on his home island of Samos, 1862 to 1920 photos and postcards, and The Tram at Karlovasi Samos, 1905 to 1939. And of course, he also authored the book on the subject he will lecture on today, The Pottery of Kütahya, published by the Benaki Museum. Now, you shall get a link to this book at the follow-up document you will receive from UCLA Center after the lecture. Now, without further delay, I would like to invite Dinos Kogias to talk to us on Souvenir of Kütahya, Imprints of History on Kütahya Pottery, late 19th to early 20th century.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Καλημέρα, καλησπέρα σε όλους όσους μας ακούν και μας βλέπουν. Thank you very much for this invitation and your kind words. It's a great honor to me to present this lecture about ceramics and history, and especially about the imprints of history on Kütahya's pottery from the late 19th to early 20th century. A few words about Kütahya. Kütahya is a town in western Anatolia, Turkey, located as the crow flies some 200 kilometers from Istanbul. Kütahya has been inhabited continuously since ancient times, as it lay on the crossroads of key trade routes linking Anatolia with the Aegean, the Mediterranean, and the Sea of Marmara. Because of this strategic position, the city changed hands frequently over the centuries. In 1428, it was incorporated into the Ottoman Empire. In the Ottoman period, the inhabitants of Kütahya included diverse ethnic and religious population groups. By 1906, the population of Kütahya numbered about 25,000 inhabitants, of whom 16,000 were Muslims, 5,000 Greek Orthodox, and about 3,300 Armenian Orthodox and Catholics. Today, it has a population of roughly 250,000 people. The Greek Orthodox community was wholly Turkish-speaking. The main products of the region of Kütahya included wheat and other cereals, fruit, opium, wool, leather, carpets, fabrics, and various copper goods. However, the principal product for which Kütahya gained renown internationally was its fine glazed ware. After his nick, Kütahya was the next major center for the production of ceramics in the Ottoman Empire. A key reason for the flourishing of the ceramic industry in Kütahya was the existence of abundant deposits of kaolin or china clay in the region, as well as various other mineral resources. As ethnic pottery production declined towards the end of the 17th century, the workshops of Kütahya experienced significant growth, especially in the 18th century, producing a huge range of pottery and tiles, often clearly influenced by Chinese and Japanese porcelain and the ceramics of Iran and Europe. Glassware production in Kütahya was mostly in the hands of Armenian potters. From the early 19th century on, the Kütahya potters established their own unique decorative style that featured a seemingly inexhaustible variety of elaborate floral patterns and motifs, painted freely and skillfully, contrasting markedly with the style of his unique ceramic decoration. They produced a wide variety of glazed ware for daily use in the homes of the well-to-do and middle classes, while besides being destined for the local Ottoman market, was also exported in large quantities to Western Europe and the Balkans. In the same period, large quantities of Kütahya tiles were used to decorate mosques in other cities of the empire, including Istanbul, Ankara, Konya, Kayseri, and Antalya. Towards the end of the 19th century, with the Ottoman economy in recession due to military conflicts, the number of pottery workshops in Kütahya decreased. The increasing importation of cheaper mass-produced European products and the conscription of many men in the Ottoman army had an adverse impact on the industrial and commercial activity of Kütahya. In the last quarter of the 19th century, glassware manufacturing in Kütahya entered a new phase. The craftsmen gradually abandoned the classic motifs of the 19th century, preferring instead to revive much earlier decorative styles, copying the Ottoman decorative motifs employed by the Sneek potters of the 16th century. This trend was due mainly to the need to produce large quantities of tiles that mimicked the decorative patterns of Sneek, usually for the purpose of repairing various Ottoman historical monuments, though also because of the revival of interest in Ottoman art in Western Europe. The construction of the government house beginning in 1907 was an event that served to strengthen the ceramics workshops of the city. The facade and various rooms and spaces inside this emblematic building were adorned with tiles manufactured in the local workshops and above all in those of Mehmet Emin, the Hajiminasyan brothers, and David Ohanesyan. A period of growth now issued for the potteries of Kütahya as they undertook large contracts for mosques, historical monuments, and other buildings against the backdrop of the first national architectural movement. The radical political and economic, social and cultural changes that followed the Young Turk Revolution of 1908 led to a revival in traditional Ottoman and Seljuk architectural styles. Inspired by the Ottoman age, the first national architectural movement sought to use classical elements and forms of the Ottoman and Seljuk architectural tradition, such as tiled facing, for the construction of modern public buildings and religious monuments. Hafiz Mehmet Emin Efendi, the greatest Muslim master in Kütahya of his time, was born in Kütahya in 1972 and learned the art of the potter at the side of Mehmet Hilmi. He became the biggest tile and ceramics manufacturer of the city. In the case of the larger projects, he worked in partnership with the workshops of the Hajiminasyan brothers, of David Ohanesyan, and perhaps some of the other smaller potteries. He incorporated new motifs and designs that reflected his own style while remaining close to the spirit of the Sneek ceramic tradition. He undertook the decoration of many religious buildings and monuments, as well as public and private buildings. He was a master of every aspect of his craft and was a pioneer of many technical innovations. Mehmet Emin was one of the most important potters and tile makers of Kütahya in the final phase of its Ottoman period and played a key role in the articulation of a new artistic style in ceramic art. Armenian artisans also played an important role in the ceramics industry of Kütahya in this final period of the Ottoman era, continuing an age-old manufacturing tradition. The Armenian potters used their long-standing experience, including the receipts, techniques, and practices of their forebears, in order to approach the quality of color and glazing of the past. They took part in trade shows and industrial fairs, gaining awards and recognition for their products, while they leveraged Armenian commercial networks to export their products to Europe and countries on the African continent, particularly Egypt. We see two dishes from Armenian workshops. On the left, a dish with a red depiction of a winged dragon, probably the Vishap, a well-known dragon in Armenian mythology. And on the right, a dish with a fish. Fish was a sacred symbol of Christianity before even the cross, and in the earliest Christian centuries symbolized Jesus himself. At the western end of the city were the potteries of the Greek Orthodox. The leading potter of the Greek Orthodox community in the early years of the 20th century was Minas Avramidis. Born in Kütahya in 1977, Avramidis is known for producing tiling and ceramics decorated with historical and mythological scenes. One of his works, a tile panel comprised of 20 glazed tiles, decorated the wall of coffee shop of Iordanis Thelaloglu, which Avramidis visited daily to drink his ouzo. It depicted the scene of the final stand of the last Byzantine emperor Constantine Palaiologos as he fought two Ottoman horsemen outside the walls of Constantinople. This is a 12-tile panel depicting the Byzantine emperor Constantine Palaiologos engaged in battle with two Ottoman horsemen outside the walls of Constantinople. It was made by Minas Avramidis in Greece, not in Kütahya. But a similar composition must have been affixed to the wall of the coffee shop of Iordanis Thelaloglu in Kütahya. And at the bottom right, we see a lithograph published by Nikolaos Tselepoglou with the same illustration which Avramidis copied on his tile panel. Avramidis usually drew his subject for popular lithographs, photographs, and engravings. In a four-piece set of dishes that are decorated with the medieval tale of Saint Genevieve, he copies four lithographs by Sotiris Christidis. This is the third plate, the third dish of Minas Avramidis from the quartet. The four dishes are on display at the Pera Museum in Istanbul. And here is the lithograph by Sotiris Christidis, which Avramidis copied on his plate. And on the underside of this plate, he signs in Greek as Minastas G. Avramou. Other ceramics by Avramidis from his Kütahya period include dishes depicting the goddess Athena, Saint George slaying the dragon, Constantine, Crown Prince of the Hellenes, the King of Prussia, Frederick II, and the Spanish King, Alfonso the 13th. This is somewhat a peculiar array of decorative themes where Greek gods, saints, and contemporary or near contemporary kings are portrayed within the rich decorative floral schemes so popular in Kütahya. From 1997 to 1919, the Ottoman Empire was involved in a succession of military conflicts, including the Greek-Turkish War of 1897, the Balkan Wars, and the First World War. The various victories, the victors, and other related historical events were reflected in the ceramics of Kütahya. A group of dishes made in the workshops of Kütahya at the end of 19th and in the early 20th century bear the coat of arms of the Ottoman Empire and the Tura, the signature, this one, of Sultan Abdul Hamid II, which reads Gazi, means warrior. The phrase forever victorious on a separate banner on the lower part of the dishes, here, most probably refers to the military events of the spring of 1897, when the Ottoman army defeated the Greeks in a brief conflict brought about by the Cretan question, which served to enhance the prestige of Abdul Hamid. The revolution led by the Young Turk Committee of Union and Progress in July 1908, under the slogan Egalite Fraternite Justice, for all citizens, regardless of ethnic and religious background, forced Abdul Hamid to concede on July 11, 1908, a constitution that restored democratic political rights. In its early days, the Young Turk Revolution was greeted with considerable enthusiasm in Kütahya amid high expectations for reforms and a brighter future. The potteries produced substantial quantities of ceramics, mostly dishes, commemorating the proclamation of the new constitution. Dishes adorned with inscriptions such as Liberté, Fraternité, Égalité, Justice, Long live the Sultan, long live the Constitution of 1908, and so on, reflect a climate of reconciliation and optimism about the future and a new age of coexistence and cooperation among the peoples of the empire. Even slogans in Armenian script were printed on some of the commemorative ceramics, such as in this plate, a dish with an inscription in Armenian, Long live the constitutional monarchy, liberty, equality, fraternity, July the 10th, 1908. But among the most impressive of the commemorative items of this period is a series of dishes showing the Greek and Ottoman flags beneath the official Ottoman emblem and the Sultan's monograph. The depiction is framed by the celebrated French revolutionary slogan Liberté, Fraternité, Égalité, which was also used by the Young Turks. The Balkan Wars ended with substantial territorial losses for the Ottoman Empire. By contrast, the Greek state doubled in size and population. Crown Prince Constantine, the successor to the Greek throne and commander-in-chief of the victorious Greek forces, who became king in March 1913, reached the height of his popularity. His portrait was available everywhere in photographs, postcards, lithographs, paintings, and so on. At his workshop in Kütahya, Minas Avramidis produced ceramic ware bearing the portrait of Constantine. This is an octagonal tile tabletop with the Greek king Constantine the First. On the back in faint Greek script to read Kütahya 1913, a lithograph with the Greek king, and a photo of Minas Avramidis at an old age in Thessaloniki. The Balkan Wars did not interrupt the flow of state commissions for glazedware. In this period, large quantities of ceramics were exported to Europe. It was a period of prosperity. However, the First World War, which began in the summer of 1914, was to impact in a dramatic way the pottery production of Kütahya. During the course of the First World War, males of any ethnic or religious background were called up under a general mobilization to serve in the Ottoman army. As the Ottoman Empire was pressed on all fronts, the ceramics workshops in Kütahya found themselves on the brink of insolvency due to the shortage of manpower, the massive decline in commerce, and state-sponsored building projects requiring glazed tiling. On October 18, 1919, the armistice of Mudros was signed between the Western Allies and the defeated Ottoman Empire. In Kütahya, the end of the war and the return of many craftsmen generated optimism for a better future for the economy of the town. In this period, we can date the dish decorated with the Ottoman imperial arms and the Tura of Mehmed VI, Vahidettin, the 36th and last Sultan of the Ottoman Empire. He reigned for July 4, 1918 until November 1, 1922, when the Sultanate was abolished by the Grand National Assembly and Mehmed VI was banished from Istanbul. This dish was probably made in the Hadjiminasyan brothers' factory to commemorate, of course, the enthronement of the last Sultan. However, hopes of any economic resurgence proved to be a distant dream, as Kütahya in the coming years would find itself at the epicenter of a new war. By decision of the Supreme Allied Council, the Greek army landed in May 1919 in Smyrna. Its mission officially was to maintain order and to protect the Christian populations until the final peace accord was signed. In the same period, in the eastern depths of Anatolia, the nationalist movement led by Mustafa Kemal was organizing its forces, preparing to take over the Turkish national struggle for the decaying and defeated Ottoman power. By the beginning of July 1920, the Greek army had occupied Ushak and Alasahir and farther north Pandirma and Bursa. The capture of Bursa, a holy city for Muslims, caused sorrow and outrage among the Muslim population and made the position of Christian minorities in Turkish towns vulnerable and precarious. Within a few years, the protracted period of warfare had caused the unifying structure of the old empire to dissolve and evaporate. In Kütahya, from September 1920 onwards, the forced deportation began of all males of Greek origin, aged 15 to 65, who were not serving in the Ottoman army on the grounds that they posed a threat to public security. Most of these men, together with Armenians, were forcibly deported in stages and sent to the interior of Anatolia. Shortly afterwards, the city itself would become the target of the Greek offensive. On Sunday, July the 4th, 1921, after a series of fierce engagements, the Greek army succeeded in capturing Kütahya. The news of the capture of Kütahya was greeted in all the major towns of Greece and in Smyrna and other cities on the seaboard of Asia Minor. In Kütahya, the Greek soldiers were allowed to enter the city on the afternoon of July the 5th, 1921. However, the Greek army had captured a city where the economically active population had been decimated. The commercial, industrial, and manufacturing activities had ceased to function because of the hostility. From the very beginning of the occupation of Kütahya, the Greek officers and soldiers, journalists, war correspondents, and photographers were all impressed by the city and its glazed ware. In Greece, such products were viewed as luxury items, for the most part imported from Europe. Here in Kütahya, however, the porcelain, as the Greeks called the pottery, all around them attracted everyone's attention. From the first day of the Greek occupation, Greek officers and soldiers went out to buy the celebrated Kütahya porcelain. For most, it was a question of acquiring souvenir of the war experience. Like Ioannis Petridis, chief veterinarian officer of the Greek army, who bought a tile in Kütahya on July the 5th, 1921, the first day of Greek occupation. Within an oval frame in the center of is a calligraphic inscription with a verse from the Quran, On lara karsi Allah sanagyater, o isitendir bilendir, Allah is sufficient for you against them. He is all hearer and all knower. On the back is written in Greek, Kütahya, July the 5th, 1921, Iota Delta Petridis, Chief Veterinarian, Drachmas 7. On the first day of the occupation of the city, a Greek officer buys for 7 Greek drachmas a tile with verses from the Quran as a souvenir. He certainly did not know how to read the inscription of Ottoman Arabic, but he doesn't choose a tile with beautiful flowers. He prefers a ceramic that strongly shows its Ottoman origin. Was it a conscious choice to prove a glorious victory, or another paradox, an addendum of war? We will probably never know. The Greek headquarters from the Asia Minor campaign set up base in the town. The war correspondent, Ioannis Passas, who arrived in the city early in the morning of July the 6th, wrote, "We stroll around the city. The stores, one after the other, have opened. At about 8 a.m., we see in a china shop the commander-in-chief buying various colored porcelain vessels as souvenirs. These are the coffee cups and beakers bought as souvenirs on the 6th of July, 1921, by Anastasios Papoulas, commander-in-chief of the Greek army." And it is Anastasios Papoulas. Later, General Papoulas also ordered a table with a 9 tile panel. In the central medallion are his initials in Greek, AP, Anastasios Papoulas. Anastasios Papoulas was the commander-in-chief of the Greek army during the Asia Minor campaign in the period from November 1920 until May 1922. And in this photo, in the center, Anastasios Papoulas in Kütahya on the July the 8th, 1921. On July the 7th, 1921, Georgios Athanas signed off a long article for the Greek daily paper Politia about Kütahya and its ceramics. The mountains surrounding Kütahya provide abundant earth that looks like porcelain. The entire industry is still in the hands of Armenians. For obvious reasons, they needed to enter business partnerships with various Turks. However, the latest circumstances of war brought a halt to production for many months. And now the two remaining stores of Kütahya sell items that were produced some times ago. They have plates, vases, water jugs, cups, and various other vessels. Their shapes are elegant, the colors lively. The secret to their quality is that the colors are natural mineral pigments. They are extracted and processed locally. The prices are relatively low, but transport is difficult, for these items are extremely fragile. The Crown Prince and Mr. Papoulas bought a number of vessels as souvenirs. Fine vases with original decorative features, plaques decorated with pretty pansies that look almost real. I saw today Mr. Bossonas buy one of these few remaining pieces. Flower vases decorated with floral patterns that are more delightful even than the real flowers growing in the gardens of Ankara. In the beginning, the stores, mostly china shops and workshops, sold whatever stock they already had. Production had ceased for several months because of the war. When the workshops came into operation again, they were quick to produce vessels with Greek inscriptions. Flower vases, were produced displaying the phrase "Capture of Kütahya by the Greek army, July the 4th, 1921, as well as tea services and other vessels inscribed in with the words Souvenir of Kütahya, Asia Minor, July the 4th, 1921, the date the city was captured by Greek forces. These are two very, very rare vases with the Greek inscription Κατάληψη Κιουταχίας από τον ελληνικό στρατού 4 Εβδόμου 1921, Capture of Kütahya by the Greek Army, July the 4th, 1921. Taraki bottle bears the words Kütahya, July the 5th, 1921, and the Greek initials NP, referring that is to the date the Greek soldiers were allowed to enter the city, the first day of the Greek occupation. These are vessels that record the historic event of the victorious advance of the Greek forces in the region and were made in response to requests for such souvenirs by Greek servicemen who had taken part in the campaign. On July the 14th, King Constantine arrived at Kütahya. At the two important war councils held on July the 15th and 16th in the government house, it was decided to advance the Greek forces to Ankara. On the occasion of the royal visit, a series of dishes with Greek flags and the royal crown were made in the workshops of Kütahya. This is a very rare dish of this series of ceramics with the two Greek flags, the royal crown, the Greek inscription, Souvenir of Kütahya, 1921, and this dish was bought in Kütahya by cavalry lieutenant Georgios Stanotas. Besides ceramics, the city also produced carpets, usually the size of prayer mats, which were decorated with the image of King Constantine, or later the military governor of Kütahya, as well as more unusual subjects, such as this 25 drachmas Greek banknote. In September 1921, after 3 weeks of fierce fighting in the Sankaria-Ankara campaign, the Greek army fell back to the Skhisahir-Kütahya-Fionkara-Hisara line. The Battle of Sakarya marked the end of the Greek army's triumphant progress in Asia Minor. The workshops of Kütahya ceased producing ceramics inscribed with the Greek victories of July, instead returning to the symbol Souvenir of Kütahya in Ottoman Arabic, French, and Greek lettering. The word souvenir in Kütahya becomes inextricably linked with its ceramics, the product par excellence for which the city was famous. Already towards the close of the 19th century, a large number of Kütahya vessels bore the inscription Για την καιρή Kütahya, means souvenir of Kütahya, in Ottoman Arabic script. These are a few vessels, a fish scale motif, with the inscription in Arabic script Για την καιρή Kütahya. During the Greek occupation, on a considerable number of vessels, we see the Greek words in capitals, Souvenir of Kütahya or just Kütahya, the date 1921 or 1922, and in the case of specially commissioned orders, the initials or even the entire name of the person who had ordered the item. For the most part, these vessels were for everyday household use. Small bottles for ouzo or raki, serving trays, vases, flower pots, fruit bowls, teapots, sugar bowls, sweet dishes, ink pots, plates, teacups, and other kinds of cups, including raki cups and so on. Soldiers also order ceramics with the names of their loved ones written on them, wives, fiancés, girlfriends. This is a serving tray with a text in Greek, Souvenir of Kütahya, and the name Zoe, female name, Zoe Moraitu. And a teacup and saucer from the same service. And also a meat jug here with the female name Stella and the year 1922 written on it in Greek. Part of Kütahya's ceramics production was sold in the city to soldiers and officers of the Greek armed forces and various visitors. With its imposing public buildings, mosques, churches, commercial streets, public fountains, and densely built neighborhoods on the slopes of the hilltop with the Byzantine fortress, Kütahya was a popular location for soldiers and officers on leave, many of whom served on the front or other distant posts of the campaign. For these men, Kütahya was a large town where they were able to relax in its urban charm and tranquility, having fun and spending their pay. In 1922, Evangelos Ganas, a lawyer from Piraeus, reserve captain and head officer of military justice in Afshon Karahisar, ordered two vases with his initials. These are the two vases ordered by Evangelos Ganas with his initials, E.G. Evangelos Ganas, and the Greek inscription Souvenir of Kütahya. And in this photo, Ganas with his wife on the rocks of Afyon Karahisar in 1922. In the same year, the Greek colonel Grigorios Vasiliou Phalereas from Mani ordered various types of ceramics with his initials in the potteries of Kütahya. This, a coffee teacup and a bottle for raki, ordered by this man, Grigorios Phalereas, in this photo as Capitan Ziakas in the Macedonian struggle in the year 1906, I think. And in the winter of 1921-1922, in the occupied zone, food and other essential items started to run short. There were serious shortages of olive oil, legumes, sugar, and meat, and the quality of the food available was poor. Shoes and clothing for the armed forces were also in short supply. While the military administration was failing to pay promptly officers and soldiers. During this period of the campaign, there were numerous cases of abuse, profiteering, and corrupt management of the army's provision. And the region of Kütahya was no exception to this tendency, as similar practices took place, including black market activity by the military administration, while shortage of food and medical supplies was making life increasingly hard to endure for the civilian population. The Greek army had no operational experience of how to handle foreign population elements of different religious and cultural background. On January the 17th, 1922, a soldier, newly arrived in Kütahya, sent a postcard to his mother in Greece. Dear mother, I write to you from Kütahya, where we arrived today midday. As a city, it is truly impressive, much nicer than Eskişehir and better by miles than filthy Afyon. I bought a few souvenirs of Kütahya, teacups and so on, and we visited the Greek church and school. But the deprivation among the entire Greek community can hardly be described. Tomorrow we depart for Afyon. Affectionately, Nikos. The letters and diaries of the Greek soldiers describe an impoverished city that lives and works, making elegant ceramic objects, expecting a few drachmas or a piece of bread, mainly for the Greek army. It is the perfect contrast. These luxurious ceramics were created by potters in conditions of absolute poverty. In 1922, we see the first ceramic vessels bearing the inscription Enthymion Κατοχής Κουτάχιας, 1922, Souvenir of the Occupation of Kütahya, 1922. The use of the new word occupation accords with the general military terminology of the time. The word itself implies a temporary situation as it designates only physical power over something rather than actual ownership, as was to become fully apparent in the most tragic way in August of the same year. The Turkish counterattack began on August 13, 1922, near Afyonkara Hisar. Although a Turkish offensive had been anticipated, it surprised the Greek military leadership and brought to the surface the failings of the campaign strategy. On the second day, the Greek line of defense split in two and the resistance rapidly transformed into collapse. The Greek army made a disorderly retreat towards the western seaboard on the Aegean and the Sea of Marmara. In Kütahya, rumors of the collapse of the Greek front were confirmed on August 15, 1922. The Christian community leaders decided to evacuate the city. In the morning of August the 16th, the exodus of the Greek and Armenian Christian inhabitants began as they decided to head towards Negyor, Bursa, and then the port of Mudania, when they would embark for Eastern Thrace and Thessaloniki. On August the 17th, the Greek forces abandoned Kütahya and began their retreat towards Sousak. Meanwhile, units of the Turkish cavalry were entering Kütahya. This is a very rare postcard showing a Turkish soldier bayoneting a Greek soldier who carries a Kütahya vase, and in the background, the city of Kütahya. The Greek occupation had lasted 1 year, 1 month, and 14 days. However, together with its Greek and Armenian population, the city had lost forever its multicultural, multi-ethnic character. The war brought to a violent end the age-old coexistence of its three principal ethnic communities. This research focuses on the microhistory, on the invisible aspects of the big event, particularly the commemorative ceramics with Greek inscriptions indicate the peaceful experiences of the Greek soldiers during the Greek-Turkish War or the sidelines of glorious battles, heroic deeds, and even atrocities. In this context, we can have a more complete picture of the daily life of the Greek warriors, which may help us to better understand the personal way in which they experienced the great historical events. The enthusiasm of the victor, the symbolic representation, the personalization of a small lecture, the future wedding happiness, but also the caution for the final outcome of the campaign are reflected sometimes in a visible and sometimes in an invisible way on these ceramics coming out of the Kütahya skins just a few kilometers from the front line. The peculiarity of these ceramics is that they constantly produce new narratives and at the same time act as a guide to access to the past, giving a human face to history. They reproduce specific words of emotions of their original owners and remain material carriers of ancestral memory for future generations. This is the end of my lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and maybe we can give you a round of virtual and real applause for a stunning lecture.
Thank you. Thank you very much.